George Adamski's story is pretty interesting. Whatever you think of his philosophy, he was a very interesting guy and had a very interesting life. He was born in 1891 in what was then Prussia, now it's Poland. He emigrated to the US at a very young age. And from then, he just kind of roamed about doing very interesting things. He was in the cavalry in the early 1900s. He fought against Pancho Villa at the Mexican border. He worked in Yellowstone National Park. He worked at an Oregon flour mill. And in the 1930s, founded an organization called the Royal Order of Tibet, which was a philosophical organization.
The Royal Order of Tibet is certainly one of the more interesting aspects of Adamski's life pre-flying saucers. Established in 1934, it was a sort of philosophical compound based in Laguna Beach. And as Adamski said in his own words to the LA Times, he was there to teach the scientific portions of Lamaism. Also in the same article, he mentions that he learned a lot at the top of the world. The top of the world is a reference to the Himalayas, the tallest mountains in the world. And that makes you wonder, did he spend time in the Far East? And yes, it appears that Adamski actually did spend time in the Far East, in Tibet. Lu Zinstag, later in Adamski's life, who became his international contact in Switzerland and wrote her own book on Adamski, as well as Fred Steckling, Glenn Steckling's father, believe that Adamski spent time in Tibet when he was young. There's also an author named Gerard Artson, who provides the most comprehensive answer to this question. According to all accounts, Adamski immigrated to the United States with his parents and lived in New York when he was around 2 years old. Due to financial hardships, he was never able to complete the fourth grade. And this gets brought up a lot when people call him Professor Adamski because he wasn't a college professor or anything like that. But in his own words, the title of professor was given to him by his students starting at the Royal Order of Tibet and then continuing on as he got into the flying saucer world. When Adamski was a child, he met a man named Uncle Sid. Not much is known about Uncle Sid. He knew Adamski's parents. He knew Adamski himself, and later, when Adamski's father died, Uncle Sid kind of took over that paternal role. Eventually, Uncle Sid and his wife convinced Adamski's mother to send him to Tibet in order to study with the lamas, convincing her that the benefits of the things he would learn would be better than him staying in New York. So she agreed, and Adamski spent, depending on which version of the story you read, 3 to 6 years in Tibet, and then returned to the United States. There is an implication that Uncle Sid was actually a space brother, knowing what Adamski was here for. way prior to Adamski meeting Orthon. However, there's no way to confirm that. I don't even think there's a way to confirm that Uncle Sid existed. So that's what I have on that. Either way, it kind of completes full circle why his establishment was called the Royal Order of Tibet. If he had spent time in Tibet, he wanted to continue the teachings he had learned from the lamas on the top of the world. There is one piece of controversy I want to discuss about the Royal Order of Tibet. According to Ray Stanford's testimony, Ray Stanford is another ufologist. He met Adamski when he was a teenager at Palomar Gardens. As the story goes, Adamski told Stanford that the Royal Order of Tibet was a front, and that during the Prohibition era, he was making communion wine and bootlegging it to the state of California. And that if it wasn't for Roosevelt changing the law, he wouldn't have had to get into all this flying saucer crap. Online, if you come across this quote, people kind of use it as like, oh, slam dunk, case closed, Adamski was a fraud, he had a history of performing fraud. However, the one thing that doesn't add up, and even in Stanford's own testimony, Prohibition lasted from 1920 to 1933. And if he didn't start the Royal Order of Tibet until 1934, then certainly there wouldn't be a need to bootleg liquor. So the circumstances surrounding that situation are very, very strange. But I did wanted to bring it up because I think that is an unnecessary criticism against Adamski that is like widely available right on the Wikipedia page. Once you start to think about it, it really doesn't hold up. However, it's also known that Adamski was not a fan of President Roosevelt. I'm not sure why. Adamski is very, very private about his political leanings, but there are several references that he did not like President Roosevelt for whatever reason.
You can take the moon, gather up the stars and the robins that sing merrily. Put them in a box, tie them with a ribbon, throw them in the deep blue sea. You can take the flowers down in Lover's Lane and that sentimental poetry. Put them in a box, tie them with a ribbon, throw them in the deep blue sea. Not for me, all that stuff, the dreams that ruin your sleep. Not for me, had enough. Love is one thing you can keep. You can take the plans and the wedding bells and whoever sings or promise me. Put them in a box, tie them with a ribbon, throw them in the deep blue sea. 'Cause love and I, we don't agree.
So it was at the Royal Order of Tibet in Laguna Beach that he first met Alice Wells, who, as I mentioned, was the owner and operator of the Palomar Gardens Cafe and was with him on November 20th, 1952. And it was with Alice Wells that George Adamski and his wife moved from Laguna Beach down to Valley Center and then ending up settling in Palomar. And that's something else. This is a little known fact about Adamski, was that he was actually married for a time. And why this detail is so hidden, I am not sure. The best theory I have been able to find on it was that she was a devout Catholic and really didn't approve of him speaking with the Space Brothers. After she passed away, Adamski felt like he was freed to do what he wanted to do and just never chose to speak about her. However, she's not mentioned in his books. It's very, very strange why she's almost this forgotten figure, whoever this Mrs. Adamski was. exploring more into Palomar Gardens, it doesn't take very long to find that Adamski did not own the property that he actually lived on. It was actually Alice Wells. Having been in the Far East and the Royal Order of Tibet and knowing what I know about his teachings, Adamski does not strike me as a materialist person. So it kind of makes sense that he wouldn't own the property and that would fall to Alice Wells.